Internationally, there are three important conventions which deal with chemicals and waste. This is the Basel, Rotterdam and Stockholm Conventions. They help us to manage chemicals so that it protects our health and the environment and also prevents waste from being dumped everywhere around our planet. In 2017, the parties to our three conventions adopted a very important decision on gender, and that is about gender mainstreaming, which means that all the activities that we now implement has to have gender featured in there. This important project that we did in Nigeria has really helped us to further understand and broaden our scope in how we can further mainstream the gender within the chemicals and waste.
Women Engage for a Common Future. We have worked from the beginning, so since 23 years, on environment and health as one of our focus areas, specifically with the priorities of women, looking at chemicals and health, also specifically women as consumers, but also women in rural areas working with waste or with pesticides. And now we have started a project in the beginning of this year, looking at the gender dimensions of POPs and POPs waste in Nigeria, where we work with our partner Women Environmental Programme.
Women Environmental Programme is a women organization. We have the expertise of reaching women in any part of the country, be it in the northern part of Nigeria, be it in the south, be it in the middle belt. We have the expertise of reaching women because this is something that we have done for over 20 years now. And we have worked with millions and millions of women.
This is a subject that's a bit difficult to explain to the layman on the street. Persistent organic pollutants are usually chemicals that are found in pesticides, industrial chemicals, and byproducts. They bioaccumulate in fatty tissues. So it means gradually they are getting stored in our fatty tissues, and which is really bad for our health.
Persistent organic pollutants. Those are organic material that persist in your body and in nature. And when I'm talking about persistence, I mean not days, not weeks, not years, maybe sometimes, you know, tens of years. Dioxin is a POP. Some PCBs are POPs, some pesticides, not all pesticides, some pesticides are POPs, some flame retardants, some so-called perfluorated material that are, you know, present also around us. So there are a number of chemical families that constitute the POP family. Well, there are a number of health effects of those POPs. For example, the most well-known health effects are cancers. Some cancers tend to increase if you have been exposed to POPs. The other effect is on neurodevelopment, whether you have a good IQ, whether you develop, you are hyperactive or not, and in some cases maybe autism may be related to exposure to POPs. And there are also metabolic diseases, diabetes or obesity, as well as several other effects, for example, effects on the reproductive health. A decrease in fertility. You know, the people are less able to have babies in the right time. You have effects also on the development of the reproductive organs. For example, something called hypospadia in young boys. You have also effects in women such as endometriosis, which is a very significant health effect in women, leading actually to difficulty to have a good pregnancy and a healthy pregnancy, as well as some cancers in, for example, breast cancer or prostate cancer. You have a cancer, you have to start, cells become cancerous, this is the first step, and then the cancer has to develop, has sometimes to invade the tissue around it, and ultimately to go and yield metastasis. So here you have mammary cancer cells that are not treated with dioxin, and in this case we have treated them with dioxin. And you can see some major differences in the morphology of these cells. They are sticking close to each other here. Here they are separate, they are spreading, they have all those extensions, and they move much, much more quickly.
So we have learned from the medical experts that POPs, such as dioxins, can speed up the growing of breast cancer cells. We have also understood that POPs, as well as heavy metals such as mercury, can lead to birth defects in children when mothers are exposed during pregnancy.
You know, Nigeria has banned importation of POPs. That is a fact. We had the first NIF, that is a Nigeria Implementation Plan, for the Stockholm Convention, under which it was discovered that the major source of POPs in Nigeria is through unintentional means.
The open burning of waste can create POPs, even the burning of agricultural waste. And this is called unintentional POPs, or UPOPs. UPOPs are released when you burn waste that contains organochlorine substances. For example, plastics that contain chlorinated substances, like PVC plastics. At the Abuja waste dump, it's mostly men who are making a living from scavenging, and they are most exposed to dioxins in the air and in their food. They might also be exposed through their skin, not just to POPs, but maybe also to heavy metals.
Look at your slippers. Your guys are going in, there's no hand gloves,
yes.
There's no boots, there's no nothing to cover, you see this thing. Don't you think that it's affecting you?
We they supply the iron, copper wire and brass, and lighter, and the cotton. But how government no go help us because of the rubber no wash, then why don't they collect for the rot? They no go buy anything for us, even the hand glove and the boots.
Unfortunately, the Nigerian implementation plan of the Stockholm Convention on POPs does not yet include actions to better protect waste scavengers or to halt open burning of waste. Women who are working and living near the dump sites are also exposed to UPOPs, such as dioxins, from the air which they breathe. And they are exposed to dioxins in their food, found in the eggs and the meat, from the chicken and the cows, which graze around these dump sites. Plastic bags, plastic bottles, PVC flooring material can also leach POPs into water and soil. Amongst all this waste, the most dangerous waste is probably electronic waste, also known as e-waste. The Basel Convention bans all transboundary exports of e-waste. Every year, hundreds of thousands of tons of e-waste have been arriving in Africa, amongst others through the Lagos port in Nigeria. The rules of the Basel Convention are to stop these imports of hazardous e-waste. Unfortunately, e-waste still arrives illegally, disguised as second-hand products.
Unfortunately, some businessmen from either side not trying to follow the rules. And that's why we exist as a regulatory agency, to make sure that what is coming to us as Nigeria, we check through it in our ports. If it's among the listed items that are banned, I mean the compounds or chemicals that are listed as part of the persistent organics, of course that will not come into the country. In many cases, the officials of those countries are not in the picture. So you see like a clandestine business. take it from this country, drop it in the other country. We've taken back about 6 to 7 ships.
In Lagos, there are 4 major areas where electronics and e-waste are handled and refurbished. Alaba Market and Ikeja Computer Village are the biggest.
Products are not made in Africa. When they are, you know, imported, installation, fixing when it has issues, repairs are done locally. If your gadget has an issue, for instance, let's say the screen is not displaying, what we do here is to remove the board of this mobile phone and work on the ICs, on the chipset on it, either replace the chipset or repair it, then we'll put it back, the screen starts displaying.
In both Alaba Market and Ikeja Computer Village, some 15 to 45,000 tons of e-waste is processed each day, containing thousands of tons of lead and other heavy metals. But there is no estimate of the costs of the pollution created by the e-waste in terms of damage to health and environment.
The cancerous hazard,
yes,
that some of these things expose people to.
Yeah.
We are aware, we are actually working with the Ministry of Environmental Protection Agency in Lagos State,
okay,
LASEPA, and they come around to do the soil test, to do the water test, and to educate, you know, us.
Repairing electronics can indeed generate pops. For example, when plastic cables are melted and release brominated flame retardants and dioxins. Inside the computers, you have circuit boards, which can contain other toxics such as lead, cadmium, and mercury. Most workers are not aware of the great dangers of handling electronic waste. Even when they are aware of the dangers, there are many reasons why health protection measures are not enforced. In Ikeja Village, it was mostly men who repair computers and mobile phones. But now, more and more women are trying to work with this refurbishment of electronics, also working with e-waste.
In repairing of the computers, what kind of protective gadget do you use?
Hand gloves.
Okay.
Well, we usually use hand gloves, sometimes, not all the time, we use hand gloves to protect our hands and with lenses to cover our face in case we are doing fixing or soldering something on the board, so okay, it won't affect our eyes.
Okay, but how often do you use that?
Sometimes, not all the time, but at least, say like 50%.
But do you know the health implication that has on
we,
you?
We do, you know, Africans generally. Let me do it fast and then let's go to bed.
You know that the chemicals that are contained in these computers that you touch with your bare hands can cause cancer?
Well, I don't know.
Okay, I'm telling you now. But we're also looking at how we can design programs that will not just empower you economically, but also address the health implications of this. And that is why we're here.
Parts of the electronic waste which cannot be used go to the informal handlers just behind the computer village.
This place, you know, used to be a designated place where informal recycling takes place. So, like about 2-3 days ago, you will have, a mountain of accumulated, you know, e-waste here. When, once the stores are dismounted, so, you know, the one they need to sell to the Chinese, they take them, they separate them apart, and the remaining one is, taken to the Waste Management Authority, you know, for proper recycling.
It is unclear what happens next. Currently, the Waste Management Authorities of Lagos do not have the installations to safely destroy this toxic waste. So where does it go? Is it contained? Or is it just dumped somewhere in the surroundings?
We need to organize them a lot better. The whole idea of what they call it urban mining, Are you with me? All those useful aspects you can get from the e-waste, let them recover that. But those that are bad, you don't dump it anywhere.
POPs are also found in industrial waste, such as in paints, in coatings, in car equipment, and in old electric transformers.
Prof, this is a typical transformer to a layperson. Mm-hmm. We don't really know what PCBs are, yes, and whether this kind of transformer has PCBs.
PCB is an organic oil, which obviously is used as insulation or to insulate some of these machines. For example, if you look here, you see here, say oil mass 0.31 ton. It's inside these transformers.
One of the biggest industrial POPs waste problems in Nigeria are PCBs, polychlorinated bisphenols. They are banned, but they remain as waste.
You have transformers that are, you know, being decommissioned. This oil are being removed naturally by people who are supposed to be in the maintenance of these equipment. And these people see this, you know, oil as a commodity, so to speak, to sell out. And there are buyers. Their trade is to do beans cake, what you know, in the local palace is known as akara. Once they use this PCB oil, the textures look better, yeah, and all that. And the oil itself does not depreciate in volume.
PCB oil is being sold as a frying oil for food. But in reality, it is a lethal poison. These women food vendors using PCB oils are unaware they're doing so and that they're risking not only their health, but also that of their consumers.
Is that in most cases like this, you find out that women and children are more vulnerable. They are more vulnerable to these things because, one, they are exposed to these chemicals on a daily basis. For instance, like you referred to, it is women that are involved in a business of, for example, akara or, you know, beans cake, you know. And obviously, you have the women involved in this trade with their kids trapped in the back and all that kind of stuff. So in terms of inhalation, they inhale these things, you know, daily.
In Nigeria, very hazardous pesticides, including POPs pesticides, are probably still used. They also still use some DDT against mosquitoes. Farmers mostly do not use protection when applying pesticides. Okay. Women Environmental Program went to meet the Farmers Union. They met them when fertilizers were being applied.
Fertilizers do not contain POPs.
I don't know if you have ever heard of what they call POPs. POPs means persistent organic pollutants.
I read Environmental, so I know about the POPs. But then I can categorically tell you that a lot of our farmers don't know what POPs are. All they know is that this chemical can kill grass. This one can be used where you are farming cassava. This can be used where you are farming ugu. This can be used where you are farming one or two crops. But the chemical content of it, I can categorically tell you that they don't know.
If men farmers are exposed to POPs pesticides, then women farmers are even more exposed. The Food and Agriculture Organization estimates that in sub-Saharan Africa, up to 80% of food is produced by women farmers. It is therefore also not surprising that residues of POPs pesticides are found in human milk.
In order to get rid of all POPs and other hazardous chemicals, we need to implement the BRS Convention in a gender-responsive way. There are a number of new and exciting initiatives and projects on chemicals and waste management, which already integrate gender consideration into them. These projects take place in Nigeria and other African countries.
In Nigeria and other African countries, we already have many good practices in agriculture. For example, in Senegal, there's a women's NGO called La Ferme de Quatre Chemins, and they are working with 100 women farmers on an innovative biopesticide which does not contain pops.
This biopesticide is made out of the leaves of a tree called the neem tree. Neem trees are indigenous to sub-Saharan Africa. Their leaves are easy to collect for free.
L'ancien pesticide chimique, on allait jusqu'à Rufus pour acheter ça. En un moment, au bout de deux semaines, il y a les arbres qui vont mettre, les plantes qui vont sitôt évoluer. Et c'est pas très bon pour la santé. Donc on a utilisé le naturel. Puisqu'on fait de la biologie, on utilise le naturel. Et c'est pas aussi compliqué que ça. On a ça dans le champ.
This neem pesticide is very easy to produce. Once the leaves are grounded, you mix them with water and soap and filter the mixture. With 1 kilo of neem leaves, you can make up to 10 liters of neem pesticide. These 10 liters can treat 100 hectares of crops. Neem pesticides are now used in many African countries, including Nigeria. It's beneficial for women farmers and also for the health and for the environment.
As you'll see from a lot of the operations in the informal sector, there is value seen in electronic waste, but there are hazardous components which are seen as a cost, and you know, they are left in dump sites and for the, you know, to affect the environment. So for us, in terms of really looking for a sustainable solution to the electronic waste problem, it's essentially a proof of concept, a pilot, to try to start classifying some of the materials that are coming from the dismantled equipment, and then also, as we said, looking at where this material is going to go to finish its life cycle.
From this e-waste, GreenCycle recovers what can safely be reused, such as copper, metal, gold, and other valuable substances. And then very toxic waste, such as POPS plastics, are taken back to Europe to be destroyed in a toxic waste incinerator, as there is no such a treatment facility in Nigeria.
What is absolutely paramount if we're trying to develop best practice for the recycling of electronic waste, then safety of the workers, protection of workers is absolutely paramount. Yeah. So, of course, and you know, in terms of trying to develop a formal industry that can tackle this problem responsibly, you know, addressing the gender imbalance in employment of women, you know, is something that we really want to look to develop.
Plastics are very hazardous when they are not collected and when they are in the communities. You know, they clog the drains and lead to stagnant water that, you know, attracts mosquitoes and leads to malaria. They lead to flooding and pollution. They leach chemicals into the soil. They get ingested by fish and other sea life, and we in turn eat those things. So what we try and do at WECCF is to teach people about those hazards and get the plastics away from the communities.
Bilikis Abiola is a young woman, female entrepreneur who has created a network of community waste collection schemes. Recyclers employs women and men to separate and clean the waste, which they then sell to recycling companies.
And you know, we have a very, you know, high standard of, you know, personal protection. So all our staffs are well kitted, and we process the plastics and then sell them to recyclers that in turn turn them into new products.
So thanks to Bilike's company, more and more parts of Lagos are becoming cleaner. Where there are no recycler schemes, Lagos is very dirty with plastics everywhere. The benefit of recyclers is that it separates the different types of plastics. Those plastics which can be safely reused, but also those with PVC, which can generate pops and cannot be used.
Unfortunately, this is not yet the case. The authorities cannot yet safely treat these pops containing plastics in Nigeria. So far, the only solution is to send them to Europe or to the US for proper destruction. But this is not happening.
Là, il y a quelques transfos contaminés avec le point rouge, PCB. Il y a eu une campagne de tests qui a été faite l'année dernière pour justement définir quels sont ceux qui sont à un niveau supérieur à la norme de PCB. S'il y a un numéro marqué qui identifie d'où ils viennent, de Dakar, Anne, qui est le poste ici, avec le numéro 64. Donc c'est l'échantillon 64 qui a été donc confirmé PCB. On a estimé à peu près à 30% de la quantité totale qui sont contaminés.
This PCB destruction project is a pilot project by the United Nations in 14 African countries. Here in Senegal, Senelec is taking the PCB oils out of the transformers, packaging the oil into barrels, and taking the polluted transformers apart. Then both are sent under high security measures to France to be destroyed. In total, 300 tons. In Nigeria, the ministry has carried out a PCB inventory and has so far identified 400 tons to be destroyed. We should learn from the past and not repeat the same mistakes. Producers should be made responsible for the safe disposal of their products from the moment that they place their product on the market. This is called extended producer responsibility.
Extended Producer Responsibility Program, EPR, is a national initiative. It's essentially an initiative to make sure that the manufacturers, the big importers or the big marketers, they have a responsibility of any product they introduce into the Nigerian market. The entire life cycle of that product, from the time it's to the consumer, and then the time it becomes a waste. Let this producer or manufacturer have some responsibility in terms of managing the waste. Basel, the Stockholm, the Rotterdam and all that. It's been identified the role of women. But I think it's a lot more in the developing country where there must be more attention to because of culture, because of religion, and because of level of literacy that women should be really supported because they are the one closest to the river, they are the one closest to the farmland, they are the one providing the shelter. We can't do without women. So I think there's need for this support that in all UN agencies and programs, I strongly feel that women component, seeing them as a very key stakeholder in environmental governance, in environmental protection, and of course, even for health, it's something we can't do without. So my take is that there's need for us to continue to support women's involvement in environmental issues.
Bringing women's involvement and gender issues to the forefront of the chemicals and waste agenda is absolutely the key, because it will support economic empowerment of women and girls and give them the voice to participate in the decision making. Together, we are stronger to detoxify the world from harmful substances and waste for our future generations.